All right, now joining me in studio is a banker, a very experienced banker, but also the executive director of Uganda Bankers Association, Mr. Owori Wilbrod Owor.
Yes.
Good to have you.
Thank you very much.
All right, so a long history there of some banks that have closed, but let's be more specific to what happened today. What's your take? What exactly does this mean?
Well, from our perspective, I think a lot of lessons for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. I think that the central bank has demonstrated very clearly its ability to manage challenges very well. Crane Bank was obviously a very big bank, playing a very important role. The fact that they have steered the process, the regulations give them about 6 months. They've done it in between October and January, probably just under 4 months, is an achievement. Never mind what the cause was. Secondly, the manner in which it has been done, the business of Crane Bank has been passed on to another very solid financial institution in the name of DFCU Bank. It means that no depositor has lost any money and nobody is going to lose money. The customers can continue to be served and do business. DFCU's balance sheet will increase. It means its capital base increases, its ability to lend and do bigger business.
Mm-hmm.
I think overall it's a very good combination, and clearly the central bank has done very well. In the background that you were showing, in the past there were some banks that struggled, and you took us through a very nice history. The Bank of Commerce, Cooperative Bank, Greenland Bank. You see that there's a shift in the way the challenges are managed, the closures, the takeovers. There was more pain then. Obviously, yes, there could have been pain now, but perhaps depositors had a rougher time. Perhaps some of them lost money. You see that when Imperial Bank had challenges, the central bank was able to navigate, get another shareholder, and business continued in this jurisdiction. Same with GTB, Global Trust, now with Crane, which is even bigger. I think that tells us that the regulator is very strong, is good at what they're doing, they can manage crisis, and it is a sign of confidence for us.
Mm-hmm. If I could just chip in there, if you can just refresh the minds of our viewers, what exactly cost Crane Bank? And also, what do you think was in the mind of the regulator or Bank of Uganda for that case as they took on DFCU? They were 13.
Okay.
But what do you think DFCU did to, you know?
Thank you very much. Well, the regulator has been communicating. Of course, there is still a forensic audit which goes into the detail of the various causes of the challenge. But the deterioration of the loan book was critical, and that eats into capital very rapidly. And that can turn around the bank, go south very, very quickly. But of course, investigations and forensic audit is going on. I think that in the selection of DFCU, first they must have considered the background, the structure, the governance framework, the whole shareholding setup. Very, very credible shareholders. You saw them on TV, CDC, No Fund, Rabobank, NSSF. And thousands of other Ugandans, DFCU is listed in the Uganda Securities Exchange. The financials themselves, I mean, the bank that takes over a systemically, you know, domestically very important bank must be solid financially. DFCU's capital position is 238 billion, and it has a huge deposit base. I think half-year financials, they were at 981 billion.
But also, Mr. Wilson.
Also, DFCU's strategy. The segment in which it plays is the SME sector, which is vibrant and important for this economy.
Okay.
So you can see that the combination of things, the decision couldn't have been better. This was a wonderful decision. We salute Central Bank. I am very confident about DFCU, and I think this is very good for them to take it to the next level.
Granted, but there are also concerns that DFCU's profits after taxation have been reducing. 2014, for instance, they had 42 billion. After taxation.
Yes.
2015, they had 32 billion. That's a whole 10 billion.
Yes.
And you remember they had the you know, they've taken over GTB in 2014. Are they really strong enough?
Sheila, I would be pretending before NTV if I told you the economic situation hasn't been rough for everybody. The banking sector, like any other sector, manufacturing, you know, transport, every sector is stressed because the economy is going through stress. And the banking sector couldn't have been spared. So once businesses go under stress, it will be translated into the performance of banks.
Okay.
That profitability alone doesn't mean that a bank can be weak. We have banks with bigger balance sheets, and they show resilience. I worked for Barclays. There was a time we did a migration. We bought Nile Bank. We expanded in this country. Profitability dropped, but the balance sheet grew. Today, Barclays is returning profit year on year.
Mm-hmm.
I think the important thing is the strategy. DFCU has a history. It is a development bank. That was its heritage. They went into commercial banking. They've demonstrated capability. We are very confident that it is a good selection, and it just demonstrates to the country the resilience both of the regulator and the player they have chosen.
Let's cast our net wider into the general banking sector of this country. There have been a lot of concerns about the high non-performing loans, and perhaps one of those could have contributed to what we're seeing today with Crane Bank. DFC is taking over those toxic loans, very high loans. There have been issues of cybercrime. There have been issues of, you know, one of the most recent, of course, is the death of one of the Eritrean who was killed.
Yes.
There's a lot of issues that are affecting the banking sector right now. Why wouldn't any Ugandan be concerned whether their money is safe or not?
Thank you very much. The money is safe. I want to give assurance. I think it is being demonstrated by the direction that challenges are being managed. In terms of the non-performing loan in this industry, as I said, the sector and the economy has been very, very challenged. Yes, DFCU has taken over the business of Crane Bank, but in the transaction, structuring this transaction, and without going into the detail, perhaps Central Bank will explain further, typically these assets will be ring-fenced. They are fully provisioned in the financial terms so that DFCU does not take the toxic aspect. However, the recovery efforts will continue, and the more they recover, DFCU will benefit from that. And DFCU may choose to restructure these businesses, negotiate with the borrowers. The intention is not to kill the businesses, but enable them recover and grow. So that's typical of the business of banking. That risk is real, and we deal with it.
How do you deal with it?
You can restructure, we can extend the tenure. DFCU is also a development bank. They could provide longer-term finance. Some of these businesses were borrowing short-term money, 1 year, 9 months, to undertake large projects which are of longer tenure.
Mm.
That mismatch can cause challenges. So some of those things will be addressed.
Okay. I'm just talking about in general, really, other banks that are not necessarily DFCU or...
Yes, the industry is looking at that. Obviously, it is a concern. Bad loans eat capital, and a combination of measures are being addressed, including the establishment of the ARC assets reconstruct, which I'll talk about another day.
Mm-hmm.
I want to go to the fraud issue. You mentioned concerns about returns and so on among our member banks. Risk in the banking sector is real. We employ people the same way, where the same place where NTV gets people is the same one we go to the same church. So it is the credibility, the professionalism of individuals. We train them. We have controls, we have processes, we have confidentiality requirements, but it's a constant process of safeguarding the institution and customers. We have to create awareness among staff, customers. Our cyber electronic controls are being reinforced and enhanced. It's a constant process. I want to tell the audience that 97-98% of the time,
mm-hmm.
attempted frauds are not successful. Unfortunately, when one succeeds, it is the biggest story.
Of course.
And we forget that...
It's an 8 billion...
I understand. But we have to realize 98% of the time your money is safe. The frauds are thwarted. And even in these instances, money has not been lost and investigations are going on. And indeed, we cooperate with the legal arms, police, courts, and so on.
Okay. Our time is fast to spend, but I have one question, and I wish you could answer this in just 30 seconds.
Yes.
The issue of interest rate. High interest rate.
That's a very
banking is such a huge
common
sector.
I tell you.
Our neighbor Kenya has introduced, they've capped the interest rate.
Yes.
30 seconds, please. Would you be in favor of capping our interest rates to enable these banks, to enable an ordinary Ugandan be able to access financing or capital or loans from these banks?
No, no, no. In 30 seconds, the answer for me and our sector is no. And I've argued this very regularly, that it is not regulating and putting a cap. Mm-hmm. The price of money is interest, the same way we buy bread and petroleum at the petrol station. We must solve the underlying causes, the level of deposit savings, okay, and mm-hmm. the cost of doing business. When another telecom came to this country, they did not need to regulate the price. Competition brought it down.
Okay.
And so there is absolutely no reason. We are now starting to get reports of the market where it was regulated. It will be interesting to share with you the outcome.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Wilbrod Owor, the Executive Director of Uganda Bankers Association, but he's also the Director of UBA.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Of course, your money is safe. That is what Bank of Uganda has told those who bank with Crane Bank. Now you'll be transferred to DFCU. And perhaps we'll have more time to engage with Wilbrod at a later time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.